Welcome to the Power Hour. If you're here for the first time, where have you been? God bless you for worshiping with us in spirit and in truth. Today, we are absolutely limited for time. Therefore, we are going to go straight into the Word of God. We have the communion service, but we need to be out of here by 12 noon. That means my sermon is going to be 5 minutes long. As fast as I speak, I think I can pull it off. Go with me to your Bibles immediately to the Gospel of John chapter 10, where we will read the final passage of Scripture that not only ends this month's series, Becoming Us, but it also ends this quarter's series on becoming. Also, it will lead us into the communion service. Go to your Bibles, John chapter 10, verse number 9 to verse number 11. I am reading from the English Standard Version. There it says, I am the door. Whoever comes in, he or she shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy, but I have come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. And verse 11 says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Can somebody say amen? Amen. 2 weeks ago, we spoke about the sheep. Last week, we spoke about the thief. Today, I want to silence all the noise and talk about the shepherd. Jesus Christ is our shepherd. Turn to your neighbor and say to them, the Lord is my shepherd. Say it with a little bit more confidence. The Lord is my shepherd. Somebody's going to help me, have to help me with the slides so that we can get into the word this morning. 5 or 6 years ago, New Zealand and Australia introduced something interesting when it comes to herding sheep. I don't know whether the shepherds got tired of chasing after the sheep or people protested about humming dogs, but for some reason, they decided that they were going to herd their sheep using drones. I think that's a genius idea. All they do is add a barking dog onto the microphone system so that when the sheep see the drone and hear the dog bark, then the sheep can go where they need to go. Some of the shepherds, being young, would actually use Star Wars background music in order to shepherd the sheep. Now, I think this is genius. This has been going on for probably 7 or 8 years up to this point. But that's not the issue this morning. The issue I have is that while these sheep are being herded by technology, I find that our generation is also dependent on something which is not God. I am not concerned about AI. I am concerned about AS. Does anybody know what AI stands for? Of course you know. Does anybody understand what AS stands for? Artificial what? Artificial stupidity. I like that. I like that. I'm going to keep that. That's my sermon title next Sabbath. Artificial shepherds. We have people who are being led by everything but God. In the Gospel of John, the book of John is a fascinating book because, unlike the other Gospels, this book went in a different direction when emphasizing about Christ. The other three Gospels share a lot of stories, a lot of perspectives, a lot of chronology, and so we call them the Synoptic Gospels. But John's Gospel stands apart on its own. It stands as a reminder that Jesus is more than just a man. From the beginning, John's argument or John's burden was to demonstrate that Christ was not just from Galilee. He wasn't just a prophet. He wasn't just a healer. He wasn't just a created being. He was God. In John chapter 1, verse 1, he begins by saying, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In verse 14 he says, and the word became flesh and lived amongst us. Because the amazing thing about shepherds is, whenever they herd their sheep and the sheep are in the pen, the shepherds don't go, thank you brother, the shepherds don't go to the Ritz, they sit with the sheep in the sheepfold. So Jesus came not as a king, not as an entrepreneur, not as a businessman, but he came as one of us. He was born into the chaos, lived it for 33 and a half years so that he could say, I have been amongst them. And so John's emphasis is, listen, he's not just an ordinary person, he is God. In fact, one of the statements that you see throughout the Gospel of John is the one that you see up on the screen, I am. See, Jesus was both humble and bold at the same time. He had earned the bragging rights. And so now and again in the Gospel of John, he would say something like, how can I explain who I am? How can I explain what I represent? And he said, I know I am the bread of life. Without me, you have no sustenance. You have nothing to satisfy the spiritual hunger. I am the bread of life. And then somebody said to him, maybe that's not enough, Jesus. What else you got? That's fine. I am the light of the world. You've been living in darkness. You've been leading each other astray like blind sheep, leading blind sheep. But I have come because I am the light. Somebody said, okay, give us some more. Give us some more analogies. We need some more anthropomorphic appearances of who you are. And so Jesus paused and said in John chapter 10, I am the door. You want access to heaven, you go through Jesus. You want access to healing, you go through Jesus. You want access to peace of mind and joy and all the good stuff, you go through. You go through. That wasn't enough. Jesus said, I am more than a door. I am not a shepherd, but a good shepherd. I am the good shepherd. And Jesus continues throughout the rest of the Gospel of John. Not only am I a good shepherd, not only am I the light and bread, I am also the vine. There's nothing that connects except through me. Everything goes through me. I am the branch, the root, and everything that you need. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And in case somebody missed it, he said it again. I am the resurrection and the life. Seven times, Jesus said, I am. What qualifies him to make that claim? In John chapter 8, as always, there's a debate between the religious leaders and Jesus Christ, and they are saying to him, you are not as important as Abraham. And so Jesus, in Jesus fashion, turns to them and says, before Abraham was, I am. Before Abraham was, I am. Wait, Jesus, that is bad English. You don't say, I am. You say, I was. But Jesus says, oh no, before Abraham was, I am. When you go to Exodus chapter 3, Moses and God are having a conversation. And so Moses is scared and intimidated. He says to God, okay, fine, I'll go. But please tell me, who do I say sent me? And so God turned to Moses and said, tell them I am that I am has sent you. Moses was sent by Jesus. Moses saw the back of Jesus. Abraham saw Jesus' day and glorified. Enoch saw Jesus' second coming. Jesus has been with us since the beginning of time. And now in John chapter 10, he declares, I am the good shepherd. He has a track record that nobody can question. In John chapter 1, the shepherd calls together men from different walks of life, different floors, and he calls them disciples. In John chapter 2, the shepherd attends a wedding. He notices that the liquid courage is running out, and so he takes water and turns it into wine because he'd not let a wedding go to waste. In John chapter 3, Jesus steps up once again to the plate, and he has a conversation with Nicodemus and tells him, you need to be born again. In John chapter 4, Jesus speaks to a woman at the well and tells her, you've been with five men. You are with somebody who's not your husband. What you need is man number 7. I am that man. In John chapter 5, Jesus once again steps up to the plate. He feeds 5,000 men with a boy's lunch. 5,000 men, not counting the women and the children. So if you say 5,000 men, 2 kids per home, that works out about 20,000. In John chapter 6, Jesus steps to the plate. He does what he does again, over and over in the Gospel of John. The shepherd keeps stepping up. And then in John chapter 10, he says, listen, I don't think you guys get it. I am the good shepherd. Amen, somebody. One more time. When you look at this gospel, Jesus used things that people could understand. When he called himself a shepherd, to us, we think it's cute and we think it's applicable. But for the Pharisees, it offended them because they understood the analogy of a shepherd. In the Old Testament, God pictured himself as a shepherd and the people as sheep. So when Jesus says, I am the good shepherd, that is a huge claim. He's not just saying, I am the pastor of these sheep. He's saying, I am God to these sheep. Now, why does Jesus call himself a door? Let's go back to the wilderness fold. In the countryside, the sheepfold was made of stones. The shepherds would rear their sheep out in the wilderness, and before the day was over, it got too dark to go back to the village. So they would lead their sheep into these wilderness plain pens. But the funny thing about these sheep pen, they didn't have doors. And so what would happen is the shepherd would sit by the door and allow the sheep to walk in one at a time. Now you're thinking, why not just let all of them go in at once? Oh no, see, you and I see a crowd, but the shepherd sees us individually. And so as the sheep are passing through, he's checking them for wounds. He's checking them for scars. He's checking to see if sheep number 1020 has made it in. He knows them by name. He knows each of their problems because the good shepherd knows you better than you know yourself. The shepherd doesn't check the sheep in order to find fault so he can chase them away. Oh no, he checks them because he wants to help them. My brothers and sisters, the sheep do not check themselves. The shepherd checks the sheep. Are you with me this morning? The shepherd checks the sheep as they come through the door. The sheep's job is to simply say, happy Sabbath, welcome to the Lord's house. Stop checking people to see if they belong. That is the shepherd's job. The only animals that check each other are monkeys. So the next time you talk about somebody in a negative way, you are a monkey. Sheep keep their heads down and they welcome each other in. Only the shepherd checks. One more beautiful thing about the shepherd being the door is that the reason he lets them go in one at a time is because sometimes the wolves would actually have this look like they were sheep. The color of the sheep and the wolves were the same. And so sometimes if the shepherd wasn't aware, the wolf would go in and eat the sheep one at a time. And so when the shepherd checks the sheep, he's not looking for sheep, he's looking for wolves. Jesus, the shepherd, is here right now and he's scanning the room. Are there wolves in the building? Are there any wolves in the building? John chapter 10, verse 7 and 9, Jesus says, I am the door. The door is mentioned four times in the Gospel of John. A door gives access. A door gives you entrance. But to the sheep, they can go in and out because the shepherd knows them. And the text says they go in and out to find pasture. When you come into the house of God, he wants you to be fed. When you walk out, he wants you to be fed. God is not sadistic that he wants you to come and worship him and praise him and sing songs and go out there and be miserable and sad and unhappy. Oh no, he wants you happy inside and outside. He wants you to have everything that you need in this life. And he's able to do it, everything, everywhere, all at once. One more thing about the shepherd I want you to understand as we go through our sermon this morning is that when the shepherd looks at the sheepfold, he doesn't see many sheep. He only sees one. He only sees one. And the thing that the shepherd wants you to understand is that when one person walks out, the shepherd will do everything he can to get that one sheep back. The sheep, the shepherd has to deal with wolves. He has to deal with lions. And he also has to deal with thieves. His assignment is to make sure that the sheep go out into the pasture and they're always provided for. Now and again, the sheep's problem is not the thief, is not the wolf, it's not the lion, it's the sheep. See, in that region of the world, they have a problem with flies. So sometimes the flies would go up the nose of the sheep. And they would lay eggs and cause germs and infection in the sheep's nose. Now the sheep, being a dumb animal, its legs are so useless, it cannot, like a monkey, dig its nose. And so in order to get the fly out, the sheep will go to a rock, a tree, whatever it can, and hit its head to get the fly out. That's why in Psalm 23, verse number 5, David says, "You anoint my head with oil." Because the shepherd would put oil on the sheep's nose and the fly would slide out. My brothers and sisters, I don't know what is causing you to butt your head today. I don't know what it is that is causing you to be frustrated. I don't know what it is that is disappointing you, that's making you knock your head against the wall of despair. But I'm here to tell you that the shepherd is offering the Holy Ghost the oil in order for you to let those problems slide out. Because the problem is not outside, the problem is inside. Your issue is not money. Your issue is not your health. The issue is your faith. The Holy Spirit comes in. He ignites your faith and allows you to live an abundant life. Why? Because the good shepherd loves you. Amen, somebody. Sometimes the sheep don't butt their heads against the wall. The sheep butt their heads against each other. The male sheep wants to usurp his authority, and so they'll butt heads because they can't use their fists. They don't have horns, and so they butt their heads, but that doesn't do any harm. The shepherd watches them, and he just separates them, because sometimes when the sheep are butting heads, the shepherd comes in and says, "Step aside. It's about me, not about you." We are nothing but sheep. And when we butt heads, we forget that the shepherd is watching. Jesus is everything. Jesus is everywhere, all at once. You see, the devil is not the only one that knows how to counterfeit. The Bible actually uses everything on the screen to tell us who Jesus is, except for the wolf. I couldn't find anywhere in scripture where God compares himself to a wolf. So if you got any wolf tattoos or any wolf symbols, Jesus is not about that life. Amen, somebody. But Jesus calls himself the Lion of the tribe of Judah. See, to the wicked, he's a lion, but to the saved, he's a sheep. He's a lamb. John said, "Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." What about a thief? Is Jesus a thief? Yes, he is. The Bible says one day Jesus will come like a thief in the night. Because some of us won't be ready. We'll be too busy grazing, butting heads, and wandering into the world. And so the shepherd will come. But the one I love is Jesus is the good shepherd. The good shepherd carried two sticks. Every time I look at art online, it gets the imagery wrong. The shepherd never had one stick. He had two. He had a staff, and then he had a stick for hitting. He hit the lion. He hit the wolves and the bears. But with the stick, he used it to hook the sheep back into the fold. My question is, which stick is Jesus using on you? Is he beating you into shape because you are lost? Or is he pulling you in because he wants you inside? The shepherd both saves, but he also protects. The shepherd provides, but he also stands guard. He is everything you need. He is everywhere you go. Why? Because he is. He is. Well, why are you guys doing like you haven't been here before? The shepherd has done. The shepherd has done. He has done everything to save the sheep. And it's not your fault. It's the technology. You're right. You're right. My sister, help me out. I want you guys to see something as we end. Alexander the Great, considered one of the most genius generals to be crowned king ever, he said this: "I am not afraid of an army of lions led by a sheep. I am afraid of an army of sheep led by a lion." What it simply meant is, if the followers are stronger than the leadership, nothing gets done. But if the leadership is strong, a lot gets done. That is why it is comforting to know that Jesus is our shepherd. He's never tried something and failed. Everything that he said he would do, he has done it. The only thing left for Jesus to do is to come back again. He is a lion who looks like a lamb because he wants to save his sheep. Oh, Lord, I'm running out of time. Let's go. Let's go. The Lord is my shepherd. I love this statement. It is the backbone of Psalm 23, but I want to do something to it this morning. I want to separate the words up so that you can see some emphasis in what David was saying. He begins by saying the. We don't worship any God. We worship the God. You know, the one that puts everything together, the one that holds it all, the one who not only created but saved. We serve the particular God. In Exodus chapter 20, I got a lot of verses today. Exodus 20 verse 1, God is about to give the commandments. And he begins by saying, I am the God that delivered you out of bondage. Thou shalt not have any other gods before me. Nothing else between me and my Savior. Not a job, not money, not people, not my spouse, not my children, not my influence. Nothing between me and my Savior, because he is the only God. But it's not enough. He said the Lord is. Not was, not will be. He is an ever-present God. The Lord is my shepherd. When things are great, my shepherd. When things are bad, my shepherd. When things are uncertain, he's right there with me. I can be up in the mountain. I can be in the valley. I can be in a storm. I can be in the sunshine. I can be on vacation. I can have my head down on the grind. But the Lord is present, my shepherd. Amen. But he also says the Lord is my, not yours. I love you, but he's mine. I claim him this morning. He died for me. For God so loved Samson, Thomas, no middle name, that he sent his only begotten son, that if Samson, Thomas, no middle name, believes in him, should not perish, but be saved. You need to make it personal. If you are here today to take part in the communion because your sin cup is so full, you want to empty it out and that's it, that's not enough. The Lord is my shepherd. But at the same time, there's something implied in this statement that I want to share before we shut this down. And it's simply this. Not only is the Lord my shepherd, the shepherd is my Lord. See, I know you've never read the text like that. It's not enough to sing praise and worship songs. It's not enough to come up in here and look cute and say amen. The shepherd is not out there to save you. He's also there to tell you what to do. So when you do the opposite, he stops being your shepherd. Stop singing. Stop attending worship if you're not willing to follow the shepherd. Because every time the sheep went astray, they were either eaten or they got hurt and bled out and died. The Lord is my shepherd, but the shepherd is also my Lord. Would somebody say amen? Let's shut it down. One more thing. I want to make this personal again. I am a sheep. Jesus has come to save me. And I want to end this by allowing you to affirm with me that Jesus Christ is everything to me. He is everywhere for me, and he can do anything at all times. If that is your prayer this morning, I want you to stand to your feet as we pray. Oh, I have a lot to say, but I want to respect the time. I believe that we can end the series. It's not enough to become more. You must become us. But you don't become us by focusing on us. You become us by focusing on the shepherd. Let us pray. Our Father and our God, our elder brother Jesus, who is also our good shepherd, and to the comfort of the Holy Spirit, who comes in to smooth the journey of life, we come before you this morning, acknowledging that the shepherd is everything that we need. He has gone to hell and back for each of us. He died on the cross to make it possible for forgiveness, for justification, for sanctification, and for one day for us to be glorified. And so we stand now, respectively, respectfully, and humbly, acknowledging that we are all but sheep. Some of us have been given the assignment of being under shepherds, but we are all sheep. We are here to listen to your word, to follow your will, and to help impact your world. And so I pray for each and every person that is present here today, that they may follow the good shepherd, that they may follow the pastor. They may not follow the elders.
They may not follow people, but they will follow the shepherd. That his voice has power. That his voice has influence. The Bible says that the word of God comes down like rain and it never, never goes down and doesn't do something. It will either be a flood or it will be a source of nourishment. And so as sheep, we listen today and we say, Lord, lead us. We are following. When we are hurt, you will apply the oil. When we wander off, you go out to look for us. When we are lost, we know that we are lost, but we don't know how to come back. If we come back, the other sheep make fun of us. The other sheep talk about us. The other sheep compare us to other sheep. But this morning, I thank you, Lord, that you know me by name. You know my history. You know my present. And you absolutely know my future. And yet, all you ask is that I follow you. Not just every day, not just every hour, but every moment. Because you are a present shepherd. May I, or those present here today, never be afraid. Because a shepherd will lead us to green pasture. He will lead us to flowing streams. And sometimes he will lead us through the shadow, through the valley of the shadow of death. He will even prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. Because the good shepherd is able. And because he said, I am able to say, I am saved. I am loved. I am confident. I am able to do all things through Christ who strengthens me, because he's the good shepherd. And now I pray, dear God, may you be above us to watch over us. May you be beneath us to lift us up when we fall. May you walk ahead of us to guide us in the way. May you walk behind us that we would never go astray. And like a good shepherd, may you surround us to protect us every single day. But above all things, be in our hearts so that we can be like the good shepherd. If this is your prayer, ladies and gentlemen, let me hear you say amen. And amen. God bless you. Take your seats.